I really want to share hope with other people, because it has been so profoundly changing for me that I can only wish that what I can say is to encourage other people. I thought that I would never see the end of an eating disorder, and I'm coming into myself now, and I really want that for other people.
This is my interview with Naomi Scott about her experience with neurofeedback and deep brain reorienting. She wrote a short piece about her introduction to these therapies, which I would like to share with you first. Quote, "I have suffered from an eating disorder since I was 13. Over the years, I tried many modalities to ease the compulsive eating habits that have plagued me for over 30 years. Much of the treatment focused on CBT. However, I've also tried hypnotherapy, gestalt psychology, creative expression therapies, and of course, medication, SSRIs. While there was definitely value in all of these therapies, none of these were able to provide sustainable and cumulative results. At times, able to stabilize my compulsive habits in the short term, none of them offered a return to normal eating patterns. Through a mutual friend, I was introduced to neurofeedback and DBR and the wonderful Helena Bester. After just a few sessions with Helena, starting with neurofeedback, I was able to experience periods in which my impulse to overeat or compensate for overeating softened greatly. And in the space that arose from that calmness, I was able to better employ the techniques that I had already learned in other treatment practices. During the neurofeedback sessions, Helena used CBT to explore the issues that underpinned the compulsive behavior. Because my nervous system was much calmer, I was better able to absorb her counsel and employ the suggested techniques. Helena also used attuned DBR, which when coupled with neurofeedback was immensely powerful. The insights gained during these sessions have completely changed my response to stress, resulting in a paradigm shift in my eating habits. I am much more calm, stable, and able to recognize urges before they arise and employ autonomy around my response to these urges. In my experience, DBR and neurofeedback are a powerfully effective solution to deeply ingrained obsessive-compulsive habits or trauma responses. Less than 10 treatments of this combined clinical approach has achieved more than 30 years of other therapies. I would encourage anyone suffering from an eating disorder to seek out a practitioner who can offer this winning combination. Naomi Scott has a background in international law and sovereign risk. She consults to the private sector and to intergovernmental organizations such as the United Nations. Naomi spends as much time as she can in forests all over the world, where her bond with nature brings her deep solace and energy. She also enjoys creative writing, falling off bikes on downhill peaks, and walking up unforgiving hills. At the moment, she's immersed in the world of Celtic mysticism through the works of John O'Donohue, W.B. Yeats, and Seamus Heaney. Thank you so much for being willing to talk about your experience with neurofeedback and deep brain reorienting.
You're welcome.
And I sent over a list of questions that you got to look over. I wonder, you know, the way I like to do this is just really play it by ear. Like, just, we'll just have a conversation about it and see kind of how it goes, rather than try to formalize it somehow.
Sure. Yeah. That's fine.
I'm curious a little bit about where you are and how you ended up working with, you work with Helena Bester, right?
That's correct.
And do you live in Ireland?
I do. I live in Ireland, but I work in various different places. And one of those places is Mozambique, where Helena is based.
I see. Okay, great. And do you mind me asking where in Ireland you live?
Of course not. No, I live in Omagh. It's in Northern Ireland.
Okay, gotcha.
Yeah, I spent time in Dublin and in Galway and kind of traveling around in Ireland. This was some years ago now. While I was a musician.
Oh wow!
Oh yeah.
I
love Ireland, so I haven't been to the north at all. So that's still on the list.
Yeah, people always skip the north, but definitely this island it's full of music. People are always astounded. I don't have any friend who doesn't play an instrument. Everybody I know plays an instrument. I play the piano and cello. My brother plays the fiddle and piano. My dad sings. My mom plays piano. And everybody that I know plays an instrument.
Right. Yeah, I think the most stunning thing for me was going to some random pub and somebody would just begin singing, or they would just pull out an instrument, begin playing, and that's normal activity.
It is. And I'm from a small town in the west coast of Ireland near the Gaeltacht area where they speak Gaelic. So it's very rich in the fabric of the culture here, very much nice. So.
Yeah, nice. Nice. Yeah, so you were in Mozambique, and how did you and Helena meet one another?
Oh, it's an interesting question, Lars. So my best friend actually lives in Mozambique. Her name is Sasha Vieira, and she has a son who was finding it very difficult to be at ease in the public school system. He was very triggered by most of the teachers that he was around, and he was unable to really thrive where he was. And somebody recommended Helena, and he's actually my godson. And the work that Helena did with him was very convincing. So it was really in that change that I was convinced that it was really worth trying it for something that I have, which has been an eating disorder for 30 years. So it was really through the direct experience of my godchild that I recognized the potential of this therapy.
Nice. And can you tell a little bit about what were you had some sense of it because of your godson's experience, but what were your expectations of what the process was going to be like?
I was very open-minded. I think I'd been doing at that point really 25 years of talk therapy and you know, certainly it played an important role in giving me perspective and coping tools. But somehow the insights didn't land emotionally in me. They landed intellectually, but I wasn't in a space to be truly able to hear them and implement them. And I'd been to so many psychologists by that point that it felt like a bit of an echo chamber. And the only thing that came a little bit closer to being able to reach the whatever part of me that seems to have been this tight nut that has the eating disorder was hypnotherapy, because it took away that defensive conscious mind that wouldn't let me heal. And so it somehow got under the covers a little bit. So I could see that I needed to be taken somehow on, either taken unaware or put into a state where I can truly understand what is being told to me. And talk therapy hadn't achieved that. So I thought if there could be a brain regulation of some sort that could assist, that would definitely help me. My day job actually is mining. So I do remote exploration and I look for unique deposits in strange places. And we fly planes over large areas and look for the aerial magnetic signature that is given off by a frequency of heat. And so I study these heat maps and these frequency maps all the time. And I know that there's electrical connections in our body and our mind that will navigate the way that we understand the world. So it made sense to me that there could be an electrical fault in my brain that had caused this at some point. So it made sense to me to try something that was more physical than working with the conscious mind.
Yeah.
That makes a lot of sense.
So when you began working with Helena, did you start doing neurofeedback or with deep brain reorienting? How did the process begin? Or did you start with just meeting in person and kind of talking about things?
Yeah, the first session was talking. And I explained the nature of the eating disorder and particularly my inability to control impulse and urges. And we did a little bit of talk therapy in that session, but ultimately she said she would like to try DBR with me. And so the next session we went straight into doing the DBR therapy. And I could feel after that first session there was, she does it and talks to me at the same time. So I think it helps that Helena is an incredibly intuitive and insightful psychologist as well as a DBR practitioner. So she was able to very quickly get to the landing spot of the discussions and the topics that I needed. But definitely the DBR increasingly put me in a place where I could be calm enough to hear the messages that she was telling me.
How many sessions, like around how many sessions have you done now?
So I have done in person probably about 15. And then she continues to do counseling via Zoom when I'm not in Mozambique. We have struggled desperately to find somebody in Ireland who will complement the therapy in person. I lived in Sydney as well the last 8 years before I moved back home. And also in Sydney, I was unable to find somebody who would be able to help me do the DBR in person. So unfortunately, I only get to do the physical side of it when I go to Mozambique, which is every couple of months.
And can you talk a little bit about the change that you felt in terms of, like, do you feel a change during the session itself, or is it just kind of a surprise afterwards that you're calling it your impulse control, that the way that it feels to you, the way that your sense of yourself in the world has shifted by doing this work?
I do feel it a little bit in the session, but because the session is also talk therapy and we're talking about, I guess, triggering things, you don't get the full sense. I definitely feel more soothed, but I don't get the full sense of it until I walk out the door. And for the first maybe 4 or 5 hours after the session, I feel an intense calmness. I can only equate it to going to the dentist and getting the gas. Because I hate injections. And it feels like this little curtain that falls. And that instinct to kick back at the world, which I do by eating, it's soothed. It's soothed. So there's a space between the impulse and the action. And I very clearly feel that. The first 4 or 5 hours, I feel it very clearly, even overnight. And then it stays with me. And I can feel that there are definitely many more insights that come to me in those weeks following the treatment.
And during the process, have you learned a sense of, you know, in the training, we put on trainings of deep brain reorienting for clinicians. And there's a lot of neuroscience involved. You know, it's a lot of understanding what the PAG is and what it's doing, how the physical structures of the brain are reacting to shock and the attachment rupture of, you know, whatever the initial thing, or for some folks, it's a long period of time of, you know, of intolerable conditions, and understanding what is happening physiologically, neurophysiologically on that. Is that a process you come to understand during doing this, or has it mostly been simply the process of doing deep brain reorienting of getting into the, you know, deciding on what is the activating stimulus, getting the orienting tension, and talking about that?
Yeah, no, I haven't discussed so much the science around what is being done to the brain and what the changes are in the brain. Helena does talk about it, and, you know, I can see things on the screen and she's pointing things out. But there's a part of me that just, even though I'm driven by facts in this area, I just trust that whatever is happening is happening. And I don't so much crave to understand it, which is quite unusual for me, because usually I need to be convinced by the facts. But this treatment is such that it convinces me through experience. Right. So it, for me, it's much more important. The talk therapy that's part of her treatment is more important, because I guess it's just landing in a way that I can truly metabolize it in the moment. So those words have so much more impact when she's saying them than at any other time. So my brain is fully on the CBT part of it.
Right, that makes sense. That makes a lot of sense. And would you say that in terms of your interaction with Helena, can you talk a little bit about how the relationship with her is actually a part of your healing process? And mm-hmm. and I frame this a little bit. Seaborn Fisher is someone who is well known in our community. You know who she is. And one of the things that she talks about is that the therapeutic relationship, the therapeutic alliance, as it's called in the literature, is a key part of the process of recovery from trauma, because the person who has been through these terrible situations needs to develop that sense of attachment with someone else, and the therapist actually works in that. I wonder if you can reflect on how that process has been important in your deep brain reorienting.
Yeah, it's absolutely fundamental. So the relationship with Helena is a relationship of trust. So I wouldn't trust technology on its own. I wouldn't trust the intent of technology, and I need to know that the person that is administering this is trustworthy. And the trust also comes in when it comes to the vulnerability and pushing through the vulnerability to understand the fundamental triggers. And Helena's is a guide that is so critical to the healing process, because there's also the part of being seen and being understood and being accepted in that space that is also fundamentally healing. I couldn't do this with a machine on my own. I need to be seen as a human in this position and feel her empathy and her understanding in conjunction with the technology. It's a fundamental part of the healing. The being seen part of it and being acknowledged is so fundamental to the healing process. And she also navigates the science of it and explains and puts you at ease with what is happening, because you can at times feel a little bit zoned out, or you can feel maybe over relaxed sometimes. And she's, you know, her words are a guide to help you be at ease with that slightly changed feeling inside you. So without that, it would feel very isolating.
And now that you've had a number of, you've done this work with Helena, you know, one of the reasons that I do this work is to try to raise awareness about that there are ways of addressing, you know, for many of us, we grew up with this idea that whatever happened to you, you just got to be okay with it. Just get over it. Just, you know, push it down, don't talk about it and whatnot. Or at best, to get to a place where it's like, we're just going to talk about what happened to you, the narrative sort of approach that a lot of talk therapy takes. And so raising awareness has become a part of what I see is an important kind of idea, that the defenses that we put up to intolerable situations are the effort of our system to try to find a more regulated way of being in the world. And what we really need to do is just create space for that process to continue, which is, you know, a way of describing DBR, right? But for people who have the kinds of questions, if you think back to before your godson went through the process, you started hearing about that, the kinds of questions that might have come up for you, the kinds of doubts that you would have about this therapy, what would you say to people who are thinking about this or you know, they're on the fence about whether they want to, you know, explore this as a healing modality?
I know it can be quite confronting when you look at the connections on your head and you're connected to a piece of technology and it reminds you of the old days when they got electric shock therapy treatment. But and so there is, of course, a lot of fear about giving somebody else the power to do this to you. But all I can suggest is that I think all of us who've been in therapy for a long time understand and recognize the limitations of cognitive behavioral therapy. And we recognize readily that there has to be another approach that puts us in a place whereby those techniques or those discussions can actually have impact. And I would advise that people just have to suspend their fears and try it, because the first session will allay their fears immediately. You know, even the first seconds will allay it, because you might expect some electrical impulses or, you know, it's a completely soothing experience. I think we underestimate when we hear about the technology, we underestimate how gentle and in many ways soothing it is when we undergo the therapy. Certainly within the first few minutes of doing it, all of my fears were allayed for sure.
So you mentioned sensors. So you also did neurofeedback in addition to the deep brain reorienting. Is that right?
Yes, that's right.
Okay. Can you talk a little bit about did you do DBR before neurofeedback or the deep brain reorienting first and then the neurofeedback part, or did you sort of explore doing one before the other?
I don't fully understand the difference between them. If you could explain that.
Sure. So when you're doing the deep brain reorienting, it would be the part of the session, and they may happen simultaneously. I don't know how different clinicians would approach it differently.
Mm-hmm.
But for neurofeedback, it's about putting the sensors on your scalp, and then you would be hearing a tone or watching a screen to see being played back to you. And the goal there is just to help what the research has shown is that your brain changes its frequency patterns based on the feedback that it's getting immediately. Because the DBR is more about you sort of internally, like thinking and processing, you're finding an orienting tension, you know, behind your eyes, in your neck, that kind of thing, and really allowing yourself to feel the changes that are happening in your body.
Yes, it does. It makes perfect sense. So they were done simultaneously. It's the technique to locate the tension and go into it was done at the same time. Well, when I could be present, it's done at the same time. When it's obviously when I'm remote, it's all the time. But she combined the methods when I was in present and in time. But all of my sessions, well, I would say 60 to 70% of my sessions remotely are the reorienting
right.
Techniques.
Sure, because otherwise you would need the technology there where you are, right?
Exactly, yeah.
Computer and sensors and
yeah.
I wonder, in terms of the clinicians, do you have anything that you would say to clinicians who are considering whether they need to learn this modality? Because a lot of, you know, psychologists and clinicians who do mental health professionals, they've studied cognitive behavioral therapy and, you know, other talk therapy, what advice would you give to mental health professionals about why they should consider learning how to do this?
DBR?
DBR, neurofeedback, from your perspective, you know, obviously you're coming from the perspective of a client. Particularly in the eager community, the goal of the work is to improve people's lives, to make self-regulation possible, for you to eventually get to a state where you can, you know, you have learned, your brain has learned how to get into those states that are more comfortable for you.
Well, the neurofeedback, to me, it's a very simple argument that it's a tool that can complement your work. You know, it puts the patient at ease and enables them to make the existing tools more effective. And we can also say the same about deep brain reorienting, but that the neurofeedback is simply a tool that can be used, and it complements everything that you're doing. The deep brain reorienting, I think this is more of a, I don't know, is it more of a gestalt form of psychology, but it, going into the place, orienting yourself in the place where the trigger arises or where the feeling is, makes so much, it's a much better entry point to the discussion than something that's quite abstract. When something is landed in the body, your entry point is so much easier, and the experience is so much more felt and so much more it's much more felt. So the experience that you're having when you're having the discussion is it's already landing in you. It's already part of you. It's already located inside you. So it's not easy to disassociate when you're in the body, and it's very quick. I would readily disassociate when I had discussions about my eating disorder, because it was such a point of shame that I pushed those discussions away very quickly. But when it's oriented in your physicalness, you can't do that. You have to face it and you have to be present to it. And it makes you much more, especially with eating disorders. Our problem is very often we disassociate with our body. And that's definitely been my major problem. And so it enabled me to be fully present in those discussions. And it's such a powerful tool that I can't imagine why any clinician wouldn't want to use it. I appreciate that, yes, it's not your typical psychoanalysis approach, but we understand that we hold stress in the body, so why wouldn't we want to use that as the starting point?
That's great. Thank you. Yeah, I am. I'm grateful for your awareness and sort of self reflection on this stuff, and also your courage and willingness to kind of talk about your own process.
Well, I really want to share hope with other people, because it has been so profoundly changing for me that I can only wish that what I can say is to encourage other people. I thought that I would never see the end of an eating disorder, and I'm coming into myself now, and I really want that for other people.
That's great. Thank you. Thank you for taking the time today, Naomi. This has been really amazing.
It's a pleasure, Lars. And I would do anything for Helena. She's a truly, truly profound practitioner. I mean, I'm very blessed to have her.
Thanks for watching. If you found something helpful, use the like and subscribe. It helps us with YouTube algorithm and lets us know we're on the right track.